Well, good morning. Thank you for taking the opportunity to worship with us this morning. I'm excited about some of the songs that you're getting ready to sing, and just really thinking about the cross this morning. Today is Palm Sunday, first time in my spiritual walk with Christ that I will worship on Palm Sunday, not in a church building, but that's okay because the church is not a building. The church is you and I. And so I hope you take the opportunity to worship with you and your family and maybe some friends and neighbors this morning. As we get started, just trying to think about the cross, think about what happened and why we celebrate Palm Sunday. I'd love to read a passage of scripture for us this morning out of Mark's Gospel, chapter 11. And so read along with me or just listen to the reading of God's Word. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethpage in Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' say this, 'The Lord has need of it, and will send it back here immediately.' And they went away and found a colt at a door outside in the street, and they untied it. And some of those standing there said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' And they told him what Jesus had said, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. And many spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut from the fields. And those who went before and those who followed were shouting, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest.' And he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Would you join me? And let's pray and just ask our Father to be with us as we worship this day. Father, thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to be your child. Father, there was nothing in me, Lord, that was becoming of you. And Father, you loved me enough that you still sent your Son in the midst of my sin to be my Savior. And Father, as we begin to wrap our minds around Palm Sunday and then a Good Friday approaching, and then, Lord, as we think about the cross, as we think about the resurrection, Lord, what a wonderful time in which we're living now for us to be reminded of this great hope that we have in Christ. Father, would you encourage us this day? Father, may your word be sweet to our soul. May our worship through music be glorifying to you. May our prayers just be lifted high to you this day, Father. Lord, thank you for loving us. And Lord, I pray that, Lord, we would exalt you with all that we have. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now would you join with us as we worship?
Oh, join us in watching a video about the Annie Armstrong Easter offering.
Sometimes people ask why. Why do we do this?
When we came up here, I didn't feel capable. Because I was scared.
Why do we take our families away from places that are familiar and move to places that are far off?
My wife was 9 months pregnant, and we did not know one person who lived in the city.
Why do we come to where there's nothing so we can try and start something?
The Lord really just, He broke my heart for this city before I stepped off the plane.
Why do we stress and strain and struggle and sweat just to make life better for someone else?
There's so many people that are broken, that are lost, and it's heartbreaking.
Yes, sometimes people ask why, and when they do, we tell them. There's places where the truth hasn't yet reached.
We need to share the gospel and reach out our community.
We tell them there's a God who loves them so much, He sent us.
God spoke to us, broke our hearts for the city, and God's call trumps all.
And we tell them there are people who love them so much, they give so that we can go.
When people give to missions, things happen. New believers are getting baptized. New churches are started.
So when people ask why, that's what we tell them. We tell them it's the gospel. It's all about the gospel.
Hey, I really do hope that you will give faithfully to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. The work that our North American Mission Board missionaries do for kingdom purposes, they really do depend upon your offerings, and so I hope you'll give faithfully to that. You can give a couple ways. You know, we're not meeting together. Many of you are mailing in your checks, and so if you can do that, 9856 McNeil Road in Kernersville, you can mail your checks there. Or, I mean, I have been so encouraged at the number of people that have gone online to tithe.ly and found our church and are giving every week to that. And you can give both your tithe and you can give to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering that way. But we worship the Lord even in the midst of difficult times by the way in which we give. So I hope that you will give faithfully. Now I'm going to turn it back over to Miss Jill Baumgartner, and she's going to lead us in reading a passage of Scripture, and then we'll continue to worship.
We're going to continue with our worship today, reading from Isaiah chapter 53, verses 1 through 12. Who has believed what he has heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. and the will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sins of many and makes intercession for the transgressors.
Yeah.
overwhelmed today for the amazing love that you poured out on us.
Yes.
It was our sins, our transgressions that held you to that tree.
Yes.
I cannot imagine the love that you have for us that would be leading you to take such a sacrifice. God, I pray that we are mindful of that. Pray that we remember that as we go throughout the days ahead. And God, I just thank you. I thank you for loving me that much, for loving us that much. God, we give you the glory for all things. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, good morning. If you have your Bibles, take them, open them up, turn with me to Matthew chapter 7, verse 1. Going to talk about a topic that's very pertinent in our culture, this idea of judge not and judging others. Obviously, unless you've been living under a hole, you realize this is a very pertinent topic for our culture. And oftentimes, what I'll do as a good researcher, no, I really don't do this often, but I did it this week, is I'll go to Google. And what you do at Google, sometimes you can type in a phrase and Google will try to finish it for you because I'm assuming it takes this idea of what other people have searched for and you know, out of the most popular searches, it tries to finish your sentence. And so I typed in, the Bible says not to, ... and I wanted to see what Google would give me as options to finish my sentence. And so here's what, I just kind of took a picture of my screen. Google says, the Bible says not to, that's what I typed, and they tried to finish my sentence with, not worry. Now, if you watched last week, that's what Jesus dealt with, Matthew 6, 25, all the way down to verse 33, don't be anxious, don't worry. Bible says, secondly, not to judge. That's exactly what we're dealing with in our current conversation. And so I say that to say this, man, we're dealing with topics that are, you know, just right along with where our culture is in our day and time. Now, I found this to be interesting, just a complete side note. Notice the second, third, the fourth thing, the Bible says not to eat bats. I don't know where that is in the Bible. I've never read that in the Bible, but Google says, the Bible tells you, not to eat bats. And so if you're hungry tonight, don't go try to eat bats. The Bible might say that you should not do that. But back to our conversation. Very clearly, Bible says, chapter 7, verse 1, judge not, lest you be judged. One of the most often quoted verses in the Bible. I don't know of any other verses quoted more often than Matthew 7, 1, other than John 3, 16. And here's the problem. Many people will quote Matthew 7, 1, and they take it completely out of context. One guy said it this way, and it's kind of humorous, very serious, you know, just one of those things that it's just funny, but it's very serious. When somebody looks at him, he says, judge not lest you be judged, he'll oftentimes respond, don't misquote Scripture lest you be like Satan. And the problem is, we like to read Matthew 7, 1, and we don't read the rest of the text. We'll read Matthew 7, 1, judge not, and then we completely disregard the part of the text that explains what Jesus meant when he said that you shouldn't judge. And as good, faithful followers of Jesus, we have to faithfully consider what Jesus says after this command of not judging. Now, let me tell you why this is complete, just such an important conversation for where we are as followers of Jesus. Well, just notice the current climate of our culture. Look at our political sphere. Even in a global pandemic, you got people that are judging each other back and forth, Republicans, Democrats. I mean, there's enough blame to go around, and they're just at each other's throats, even in the midst of a global pandemic. Even this week, Mayor de Blasio of New York City, he began questioning Samaritan's Purse. Samaritan's Purse is on the ground. They set up makeshift hospitals, as they often do when there's a major catastrophe, and they're there serving the people of New York City. And his question was, are you really going to serve the people of the homosexual community here in New York City? And now, as ludicrous as that sounds, there's people who have that idea, that think Samaritan's Purse is so judgmental that they wouldn't do that. Jonathan Merritt, who oftentimes he's a contributor to newspapers, he writes a lot of guest columns. He wrote a column in defense of Mayor de Blasio, and he began to
get a lot of pushback, and some of that I think is rightly warranted. But a lot of people began to call him names that I can't repeat here, names that I wouldn't even repeat to you in person. And here's what Jonathan Merritt said in one of his latest tweets. He said, when I look at their profiles, he said, a lot of these people claim to be followers of Jesus. They claim to be Christians. And for people who are followers of Jesus, we can't respond like that. That's not a response that is honoring to the Lord. And so as we dive into this text, I want to talk about what judging is, what it's not, and then walk through how as followers of Jesus we should not judge others. And so first of all, let's talk about what it does not mean. Okay, so here's what it doesn't mean. It doesn't mean that we can never tell somebody that we're wrong. Okay, and so if you've got your Bibles, look, chapter 7, verse 6. Jesus calls people dogs and pigs. I don't encourage you to do this. Don't go call anybody a dog or a pig. But Jesus does. Look on down to verse 15, chapter 7, verse 15. He calls people false prophets. If you go back to chapter 6, Jesus says, he calls that the Pharisees. He says, you're a bunch of hypocrites. And in fact, a little bit later, he calls the Pharisees a bunch of snakes. Okay? John chapter 7, verse 24 or verse 25. I can't remember which one. Jesus gives a command. He says, don't judge just by appearance, but as my children, as my disciples, judge, it's a command in the Greek text, judge with righteous judgment, okay? And so it can't mean that we never tell anybody that they're wrong. Even, just not Jesus, think about John the Baptist. Herod was living in sin, sexual sin. John the Baptist goes and confronts him, and he ends up losing his head because of it. Paul, he was dealing with sin, 1 Corinthians 5. Wasn't even there. The sin was so grievous. Paul says, I'm not even there, and I have already judged such a person that is living in such sin. And so whatever this idea of judging not, whatever it means, it doesn't mean that you can never tell somebody that they're wrong. And so here's a question. So what does judge mean? What is this word in the original language? It's the Greek word krino. I found it transliterated into English, K-R-I-N-O, krino. What does it mean? Craig Blomberg, New American Commentary, he says you got two options. This word can mean two things in the Greek text. He says it can mean to analyze and evaluate, like you think about a situation, you analyze it and you evaluate it, or it can mean that you condemn or you avenge something. I think you're smart enough, you get this. Do we analyze and evaluate situations all the time? Absolutely. You've been given a brain. That's why you're the pinnacle of God's creation. You've got a wonderful mind, and God wants you to use that. But are you to condemn and live in a judgmental spirit? No, that's exactly what Jesus is saying here in this text. You don't have the right to act as judge over people. You don't have the right to condemn people in your life. But to evaluate, analyze, you all the time we do that. If I were to get up from this chair, go into our kitchen, and pull something out of the refrigerator and notice that it's got green stuff on it, pretty good chance I'm not going to eat that. Why? Well, God's given me a mind. I analyze, I evaluate, say, you know what? That's not going to be good for me. But, however, I never condemn people. Well, I say I never should. I'm not perfect, but we never should condemn people. That's not our job. That's not our responsibility. And that is what Jesus is telling us we're not to do. And he gives two reasons we're not to do this. I want you to note them with me. They're just very clear in your text. Note them with me. Number one, we are not to judge because we are merely human beings. Notice what he says here in the text. Don't judge lest you be judged. For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. And so, in other words, if you live as the judge and you condemn people, God's saying, you know what? You're merely a human. You don't see the hearts, you don't see the minds, you don't understand. But I tell you what, here's my warning. If you live with that judgmental spirit, it's the same way God says that I'm going to judge you in your life. And you see, you're just a human. But you've got a, you serve a heavenly Father that he can see things you don't see. He sees the heart. He sees the motives. He sees everything. He's appointed a day of judgment. And he says, I'm going to be the faithful judge. But you don't see those things. And I'm not giving you the responsibility to be that judge. It's not your responsibility. You're just a human. Well, question. How do we know if we've moved from evaluating to condemning? J.D. Greer, I often times quote J.D. Greer. Here's what he says. He says we've moved into condemnation or judgmental attitude when we assess a person's position, but we dismiss them as a person. So we assess their position, and we're only concerned about their position. We dismiss them as a person. Jesus is a good example of how we don't do that. Remember John 3:16, God so loved you, God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. You know what he says right after that? Jesus said, you know what? But I did not come into the world to condemn the world. Rather, you know what Jesus did? Even in the midst of our sin, he brought us closer to him. Did he tell us the truth? Oh, yes. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes through the Father but by me. He says just a little bit later, there's going to be people who says to him, Lord, Lord, and Jesus is going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. He's going to say that there's a way that's wide, and many people are going to perish that way. But he says, you've got to come by the narrow way. He told us a lot of truth, but he never dismissed us as people. In fact, he would go on and he would give his life for us. Why? Because he assessed our position, but he didn't dismiss us as people. In fact, he loved us and he brought us closer and closer to him. That's the model that we follow. We tell the truth in love, but we don't dismiss people unless one thing has happened, and I'll get to that a little bit later. And one of the worst ways we fall into this trap is social media. I see people all the time on social media, and we completely dismiss people. All we're worried about is winning an argument. I want you to listen to me. I wish I could just get right up front in the camera. The people we disagree with, many of them will die and spend eternity in hell. And we're more worried about getting them to see our point of view than we are whether or not where they'll spend eternity for the rest of their life. And I wonder how many of us pass into this judgmental spirit because we're simply trying to win an argument and not being concerned about where they're going to spend eternity the rest of their life. You see, that's what he doesn't do. He assesses position, yes, but he doesn't dismiss the people. I think about that and I think about my own life. There's been a lot of times that I've done things that I've done that have broken the heart of God. And I'm thinking primarily before my salvation. And done things I'm not proud of. I've done things that I'm sure disappointed my Heavenly Father. But you know, God never turned his back on me. He never dismissed me as a person. Rather, he came, he brought me closer. He loved me enough that he gave his son, and his son gave his life on a cross for my sin. And that's how we live. We don't condemn people. That's not our responsibility. Our responsibility is to love them enough that we show them Jesus in our life. And so why shouldn't we judge? Well, we don't judge because we're just humans. But I want you to notice the second reason that we don't judge. It's not just that we're humans. We are messed up humans in our life. And notice what Jesus says next. Why do you see the speck that's in your brother's eye, but you don't see the log that's in your own eye? Here you are, you're trying to remove just a tiny piece that's in your brother's eye. Now notice the family relationship. I think he's referring really to the body of Christ. Here you are trying to get something out of your brother's eye when you've got like a 2x4 that's protruding from your own eye. Now no doubt, if you ever get a speck in your eye like a piece of sand, it hurts. It's irritable, you want to get it out. It's something that needs to come out, but who has the bigger problem here? It's clearly the one that thinks he can go fix his brother's problem without addressing the sins of his own heart first. I love what John Stott says here. He says that, well, first of all, let me just say this. And this idea exposes two truths of our heart. First of all, it shows us that we're really more prideful than what we think. You know, here's what John Stott says in reference to that. He says, we have a fatal tendency that we exaggerate the faults of others while we minimize the gravity of our own sin. He said, we seem to find it impossible when comparing ourselves with others to be strictly objective and impartial. Yeah, now, here's the truth. And he says, because that way, we experience the pleasure of self-righteousness without the pain of repentance. Do you see the problem here? Do you see the pride in this? And here's what normally happens. Just consider your own testimony, for example. You come to faith in Christ. And if you're genuinely saved, God has transformed your life. You look differently. You live differently. You grow. You know, you think about what Peter says, that we're to grow in our relationship with Jesus. And you've done that. Your life changed, and your maturity has changed, and you're growing in your walk. Oftentimes what happens is you develop a nose like Pinocchio. Not in the sense that you begin to lie, but you get this long nose that you begin to look down upon others. And you begin to think, you know what? I'm better than that person. The person who used to live exactly like you lived, now you begin to think you're somehow better than that person. You know, that's exactly why you're not saved by your works. That's exactly why you live with the truth of what Paul said in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. For it is by grace through faith that you've been saved, and it's not of your own works, because if it was of your own works, you would boast, you would tell the world how you have come to get to a relationship with God. And Paul says, you've not done that. It is only by the grace of God that you where you are. And you see, that's why you can't look down your nose at somebody else. Because if it weren't for the grace of Jesus in your life, that's exactly where you would be. And you see, when we begin to live in this pride and it props us up on a level that we had no business being, when we're not walking in the humility of Jesus, we live in a judgmental spirit. We begin to condemn others. You see, it's not just that it shows us our pride. We're more prideful than we think. Jesus, you notice what he calls us in verse 5? We're more hypocritical than we think. Notice what he says. He said, you're a hypocrite. And remember what a hypocrite is? It's the person who wears a mask. It's the person who acts like he's one thing, and in reality, that's not who he is. You see, when you begin to elevate yourself and begin to think you're somehow better, you're living a lie, because that's not where you are. You didn't work to get there. It is only by grace that you where you are in your relationship with Jesus. And so here's what Jesus says. Jesus said, get the log out of your own eye so that you can see clearly to get the speck out of your brother's eye. So what do? We preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to ourselves over and over and over. We continually remind ourselves of the grace of Jesus that has been shown to us. We continually lay our hearts before Jesus, confessing any sin that we have. And you know what happens? Sometimes, not all the time, sometimes, when we begin to evaluate our own heart and we preach the gospel of grace to us, and we get this big 2x4 out of our eye, we look at our brother and we say, well, where'd that speck go? You see, in reality, it's your own sin that contributed to the problem. And oftentimes, sometimes what happens is your sin had more to do with your brother's speck than anything else. Jesus said, get the log out of your own eye. Get the log out of your own eye. That changes how you see things. Then, go get the speck out of your brother's eye. You get the log out. Maybe you lay your heart before Jesus. You preach the gospel to yourself. Your heart's pure before the Lord. And then, you go to your brother. You still see that speck. You go. And then,
you get the speck out of your brother's eye. Now, how do you do that? Grace and truth. You have to go in grace and truth. If all you do is you go and you go to your brother, get this out of your eye, you know what happens? You're a legalist. Your brother's not going to listen to you. You're going to be more hurtful than you are helpful. But if you go in grace and you go in truth, and hey, brother, man, I'm not any better than what you are. And man, I come as humbly as I can, but I see a flaw in your life. I see something that's got the potential that it can really destroy you. Man, can I walk beside you and help? Let's work through this together. Grace and truth. You're a brother. Somebody said it this way. You're not to be the judge. You're not to be a judge. You're not to be a hypocrite. You're not to be prideful. You're not to be foolish. You're to be you're to be a brother. You're to be somebody who loves your brothers and sisters in Christ. And you examine your own heart. You examine your own motives. And if you see that your brother's living in sin, then you go. Not with the purpose of condemning him, but with the purpose because you've evaluated and you've analyzed and you've got the potential to destroy your brother. And you don't want to see your brother do that. Don't judge, Jesus says, because, hey, you're merely a human being. You can't see the hearts and minds of others. Don't judge because you're messed up. I mean, you've got logs and 2x4s in your own eyes. But then I want you to notice this final thing. As a child of God, we never act without judgment. Notice what I'm saying? We're not to judge, but you don't live your life without judgment. God's given us brains. He's given us minds. And we're to use those things. Now come down to verse 6. Here's where I get it. Jesus gives us a command. It's the same command, okay? Just as he says, judge not in verse 1. It's a command in verse 7. Verse 6. Do not do this. Don't give the dogs what is holy. And don't throw your pearls before the pigs, lest they trample them underfoot and turn and attack you. Okay? And so when he says don't give what is holy to the dogs, I think what commentators say is you think about the sacrificial meat that's been offered on the altar, not to the pagans, but to Yahweh of the old covenant. Okay? You don't take that meat and give it to the dogs. You don't take pearls, something that's very precious. You don't give it to pigs. And man, can you imagine? You sitting down to eat and you're thinking you're getting a ribeye steak, and then they take the platter off and it's a carrot. No, you don't want that. They'd be mad, and they might turn and tear you to pieces. Vicious dogs. Not. I've got a little puppy, Annabelle, and she's got a 10-pound Yorkie. Cute little thing. No, it's vicious dogs. Pack of dogs. Hungry dogs. And that meat might not be enough for them, and they'll turn and they'll attack you because they're still hungry. Those pigs and thinking they're getting good corn might turn and attack you when it's just pearls, even though it's so precious. Well, what's he talking about? Dr. Aiken says it this way. Jesus is warning us not to force the gospel. That's the thing that is holy, the preciousness of the pearls. Don't force the gospel on those who are not only unreceptive, but they're actually hostile to our witness. Cynics and mockers will seldom listen. And he says, move on to seek out those with receptive ears. Otherwise, you run the risk of ravenous and savage dogs tearing you apart verbally and possibly even literally. Dogs have no reverence for sacrificial meat. Pigs have no value for precious pearls. And they'll just spurn and ridicule it. And this is the only time. Remember what I said? There's only one time to dismiss a person. It's the only time I know that you do this. And you're not really dismissing the person. You're just leaving them alone. Remember what Jesus said? Matthew 10, he's sending the disciples out. And they're going into the world to share the gospel. Here's what Jesus said, Matthew 10, 11 through 15. When you enter a town or a village, find out who is worthy, and you stay there until you leave. Greet the household when you enter it. And if the household is worthy, let your peace be on it. But if it's unworthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone does not welcome you or listen to your words, notice what he says,
You shake the dust off your feet when you leave that house or town, because truly I tell you, it will be more tolerable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah than for that town. Really, you know what Jesus is saying there in Matthew 7 and Matthew 10? It's the truth of what the author of Proverbs, I think it was Solomon, what he said in Proverbs 9, verse 8. He says, don't correct mocking scoffers. They're going to hate you. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. This is the ESV here. He says, don't bother correcting mockers. They're going to hate you. There are going to be people in the world that you're going to try to share Jesus with. They're going to hate you. They're going to ridicule you. They're going to put you down. Some of them may even kill you. And there are times you just don't go share. But then, you correct the wise, and they will love you. You've got to live in wisdom. James 1. Any of you like wisdom, let him ask of the Father who gives freely, and he'll grant it to you. You walk in integrity and righteousness. And the writer of Proverbs 2, says he'll give you the wisdom that you need. Charles Spurgeon said it best. Charles Spurgeon said, we're not judges, but also we're not fools either. You see, we as Christians, we don't live in this place of condemnation or a judgmental spirit. But you're never to act without judgment in your life. God's given you a sharp mind in where to use that. And so let's tie this together. How can we live in faithfulness to this text, not living with a condemning, judgmental spirit? Here's what I would say to you. And I'd give you just three pieces of advice, and then I'll close. Number one, we preach the gospel to ourselves. We continually remind ourselves of the grace of Jesus. We continually lay our hearts before the Lord and examining our heart and our motives. Are we walking by the flesh, or are we walking in the Spirit? Are we trying to help our brother be faithful in his walk with Jesus? Or are we more concerned about getting our viewpoint out there? Preach the gospel to yourself at all times. Number two, let the Word of God guide you in all that you do. Don't worry about the opinions of others. Sometimes we're so worried about what others think of us that it drives us to make decisions that we wouldn't ordinarily make. Are we guided by the Word? Or are we being faithful to the text? Or is it merely just a difference of opinion? We live in a very diverse culture. And just because you have a certain way that you sing and you honor the Lord and you've got a certain way in which you live, sometimes there's a person that they love Jesus with all they have, and they honor the Scriptures, they honor Jesus, but it's just different than you. Is it a difference of opinion, or is it something that's contradictory in the Scriptures? Okay? So we're guided by the Word. And then here's the last thing in what Jesus says just a little bit later. I think we'll get to it next week in our text. Be guided by the golden rule. If you were in your brother's position, how would you want to be treated if you were there? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Be guided by this principle in your life. And I think you'll do well with this idea of not judging others. One more thing before we go. Maybe you're here or you've watched this video and you've never trusted in Jesus. In just a moment, I'm going to close this in prayer. And I want to invite you to join me in prayer. And I want to invite you to trust in Jesus for your salvation. You know that you're a sinner. You know that you've messed up. You know that you need Him in your life. You believe that He came and He died in your place, but you've never asked Him to be Lord of your life. As I bow and I close this in prayer, I want to invite you to pray with me as I pray. Dear Lord Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner. I know I've messed up. But Lord, I believe in You
I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you came, that you lived perfectly. I believe that you died on a cross for my sins. I believe that you were resurrected 3 days later. And I'm asking you, forgive me of my sin. I want to ask you to be Lord of my life right now. I don't want to live for myself anymore. I want to live for you. And if you've prayed that prayer, I want to invite you to make that known. Send me a message on Facebook. Let others know of your decision. Now, would you pray with me as we dismiss our service? Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for the reading of your word. Father, I pray that you would help those who are called by your name. Yeah, Lord, we would repent of our sin. And Lord, I pray that we would not walk with judgmental spirits. We wouldn't be condemning of others. That we would love others. That we would walk with grace and truth. And not that we wouldn't tell someone they're wrong, but we would do it in a spirit that would be honoring and pleasing to you. Father, thank you for this time that we get to share your word together. Thank you for the truthfulness of your word, Father. And I pray and I trust that it would not return void. In Jesus' name I pray.